Okay, so getting into doing surveys, and you guys are going to do a cumulative project of this at the very end of this, right before spring break too, where you're going to go out and you're going to sample, you're going to interview some people. Whether if you're in school, it'll be, you can go interview other classes. We'll set some things up for you guys to do that. If you're not in school, you can send stuff out to your friends or post it on social media, go to the mall, go outside Walmart, talk to people. Okay, but we're going to get to that stuff here in just a minute. Who said something? What is this? No, you don't need to take any notes, because a part of your assignment is to come back and copy some of these notes that I've already posted for you guys. Okay. And I'll talk about that when I'm done with the assignment. So statistics is a lot. There's a lot to go over, and we're not going to go over it entirely in depth in this class, in this unit, in this semester, but there's statistics all over the place. Any sports fans in here? If you are into any sports. If I had a dream job, Christian, it would be to work for like a major sports organization, preferably like baseball, simply because there's more statistics in baseball and softball than any other sport, right? NBA, basketball, they have like five main statistics. Points, rebounds, steals, assists, and blocks, right? Baseball has got so many statistics that they even have a whole study of field called sabermetrics. You ever seen the movie Moneyball? Like, I would love to have a job like that if I wasn't teaching. Or work for like the Spurs or the Cowboys, or somebody who is like literally interested in, and all I would do is analyzing data and find the best players to play for my organization. That would be a cool job, right? There's statistics all over the place too. I like to show this video that, if it'll pop up. Why is it not popping up? Hello. What the hell? There it goes. Kind of. Things are in slow. I just found this morning because I had an older version of this from 2019, and they updated the video with a lot of cool, interesting numbers. It's nothing other than just something I think is kind of pretty cool. So if you want to just watch this here for the next couple minutes, it's got a lot of interesting facts in it. If everything will actually run. No, come on. Fortnite still? No? That was like all the rage just 2 years ago. What? You know all the Fortnite dances? I bet you do. You on Facebook, or is that for old people only? Just so I'm old? Yeah. I have an Instagram too. Does that make me old? I don't have a TikTok though. That's all you guys. That's you genials. Hopefully that's not me later on down the road. That's so crazy. some of you probably right during class, Netflix, and Spotify. What do I use, Spotify or Apple Music? Or Google? Is it better than Spotify? What if you don't have an iPhone? Android's better. What? Yeah, it's on Samsung. What did it say? No, this is the computer. It's just because it's trying to show the video through the Zoom. Look at this one. 25% of the population in China with the highest IQ is greater than the total population in North America. That means that the top 28 in India. That means that they have more honors kids than North America has kids. That's crazy. Oh, y'all are Gen Z? Is that what y'all are? That's y'all's generation. Like when y'all say, okay, boomer, do you know where that's from? It's because baby boomers were a generation of during post-World War II. Why were they called the baby boomers? Why? What happened? Everybody came back from the war and got busy, right? That's exactly what happened. That's why they're the baby boomers. You've seen this image so many times? Yeah, it's all right. Well, we won't finish that. Not video. You get the gist of it. But a lot of that stuff, we're getting all that numbers from statistics, from data. And I'm gonna show you guys, or I'm gonna teach you guys about different types of data collection and sampling, starting with doing surveys and seeing how we make good surveys and bad surveys. And then we're gonna jump into biased surveys. And there's a lot of bias in the media right now. There's a lot of bias on news and in the country and in politics in general. And we're going to touch on a few touchy subjects. And I'm not going to get political here, but I just want to show you guys a couple of things about that. So first, I got to get through some definitions. There's a bunch of definitions in here, but I don't want you to write anything down because you're going to go, as part of your assignment later, you're going to go back and put these definitions into your assignment. Okay. First, we talk about the population. Population doesn't necessarily mean the population of everything. If I asked you, hey, what's the population of Lehman High School? What? Give me a number about. 6,000. 6,000? You think there's 6,000 people here?
No.
1,000.
Y'all are so bad at estimating.
600,000.
Jasmine, what do you think? How many students do you think are at Lehman? I said higher when you said 1,000. Lower. It's about 2,200 students, right? Do you guys know how that there's that many students here? I mean, last year, the halls were so full before the pandemic. Yeah, there's a ton of students, 2,200 students, all right? So population of Lehman, if we're just talking about students, 2,200. Population of Kyle? Anybody know? No, it's not that high yet. It's like 22,000.
No.
Yeah. Back in the year 2000, there was only 5,000 people in Kyle. They've quadrupled in size in 20 years. It's crazy, right? Population of Texas, about 30 million. Population of United States, about 350 million. Okay. But when we're talking about population in examples for sampling and surveys, we're looking at just the people that we're interested in. If I want to take a sample of people from the population, a sample is where I get all the information from. If I take you guys as a representation of the senior class, I would interview you about whatever it is I want. Where do you want to go for the senior trip? And I'd take your answers, and your answers is a sample that's representative of the whole senior class population, right? Because you're all seniors, aren't you? Okay. And you all want to go on a trip, I hope. You want to go somewhere. All right. Okay. I'm going to, and here's it. I just have a little graphic here. You can see population is everybody. My sample is just some of those people, the people that I have selected for my survey or my experiment or whatever it is that I'm doing. All right. I have some examples here. Help me with these examples. All right. Help me with these examples. I'm going to read them out, and all you have to do is identify the population and the sample. This is going to be super easy. You're going to see this, but I just need you guys to pay attention. So the principal of Eastland High School wants to estimate the proportion of parents or guardians who are satisfied with the school's communication methods. He uses an alphabetical list of all students in the school, and the principal chooses 500 students at random and mails a survey to the address listed for each student. Of these, 94 return the survey. 94 return the survey. Tell me. What is the population? In other words, who is the principal interested in getting information from? Not just the 500. All the students in general. Not just the students, actually. Who's he really interested in? The parents and guardians of the students. Those are the people he's interested in. That's who the population is. Okay. Population is your target audience. Who are you interested in? What's the sample? The sample is who we actually get the information from. What's the sample in this scenario? Be specific. Exactly. Say it again, Jojo.
The 94 students.
The 90, not students, but the 94 parents that returned the survey. Okay. That's our sample. We sent out 500 surveys, but 406 didn't get sent back or answer. Okay, I can't get data from 406 people that didn't respond to my survey. Okay, the sample is only people that I get this information from. Got it? All right, here's another example. Help me out with this one. A shipment of batteries must pass inspection before it can be sold in stores. Two boxes of batteries from the shipment are randomly selected for testing. If more than 5% of the batteries are defective, the shipment will be returned. What's the population? Yeah, here. What's the population? Follow along. Adrian, what do you think? Do you agree with him? He said a shipment of batteries. That's correct. All the batteries in that shipment, that's the population. That's what we're interested in, right? What's the sample that we take? And be specific with your number. Well, 5% is what we're testing. Where are we going to get that testing from?
The two boxes.
The two boxes of batteries is what we're going to test. That's going to be our sample. You guys kind of see this now? All right, I don't know if you got it all yet. I'm going to give you another example. All right. Sociologist wants to know the opinions of employed adult women about government funding for daycare. She obtains a list of the 520 members of a local business and professional women's club and mails a questionnaire to 100 of these women selected at random. Only 48 questionnaires are returned. Alyssa, what's the population? I'll give you a hint. It's in the first sentence.
Employed adult.
That's correct. Good job. The sociologist is interested in those opinions of employed adult women. That's our population. So we're going to try to figure out the understanding of all employed adult women, but we're taking a sample instead. And what's our sample going to be? Claudia? The which one? Did we get our questionnaires from all 520 people? How many did we get them from? Did we get them from all 100 people?
Oh, no, only 48.
Only 48, yeah. We sent it to 100 people, but not everybody sent it back. So there were only 48 people from that club. Okay, that's our sample. Last one. You ready, Christian? This is up your alley right here. Yeah. Sports writer wants to know how strongly Lafayette residents support the local minor league baseball team, the Lafayette Leopards. You want to play? You want to play big league ball? Maybe. She stands outside the stadium before a game, interviews the first 20 people who enter the stadium. What's the population? It's in the first sentence. Not the population. Population, who is the sports writer interested in? The Lafayette residents. All the residents. Jocelyn, where's the sample? What do you think? Christian said it the first time. Did you hear what he said? Anybody help her out? 20 people who entered the stadium. Okay. Now, is this a very good interview? Is this a very good survey? Why not? If you're just interviewing the first 20 people that enter the stadium, how much they support their team, what do you think is going to happen? You might not have enough data. If you're the first 20 people to come to the baseball game, are you pretty strongly supporting that baseball team?
Yeah.
Probably. Yeah, that's not going to be a very good survey. So that's what I wanted to get into with you guys, is talking about how we conduct these surveys and how good or bad they can be. What do you know about census? What censuses do you know about? Or sense? I think it's, is it sensei? I don't know. How do you say census plural? I'm not an English teacher. You guys help me out. What census do you guys know just took place last year? What do you know about the census? The U.S. Census. Your parents just took part of this. Everybody's parents just took part of this last year. What? Not voting. You didn't have to. You didn't have to vote. Yes. Every 10 years, the U.S. conducts the U.S. Census. And your parents, unless you're 18 already, have to fill out a survey, either online, mostly online, sometimes over the phone, and sometimes they come knocking at your door. And they ask, how many people live there, right? How old are they? Okay, what's your race, if you want to give that information? How much money do you make, if you want to give that information? We want to know how many people live in the United States. We need to know that. Okay, it happens every 10 years because it takes a long time to interview 350 million people. But we have to know that information because the city of Kyle needs to know, do they need to build another high school? Right? Hasty ISD needs to know this information. Do we need another library? Do we need another fire department on this side of the highway? Okay, these are the things that we have to build, and we can't build that stuff if we don't have an accurate representation. But why do we only do it every 10 years? It takes a long time to do it. And that's why, instead of doing a census every time that you want to find information out, you take a sample. If I wanted to find out what kind, let's say I'm going to install 3 vending machines in the hallways for the students here. Before I do that, I want to find out what kind of candy and what kind of drinks you guys want in there. What kind of snacks? Do I have time? You think I have time to interview all 2,200 students here? No, but I can take a pretty good sample and interview 100 students or even 50 students and get a good idea of what you guys want in that vending machines. As long as I pick a sample that represents everybody at the school, okay? If I only interview freshmen about what they want in the vending machines and I'm going to install the vending machines next week, how would you feel about that? You think freshmen would pick the same things that you want? Maybe not. Maybe not. I'd be kind of pissed off they left me out, right? That doesn't represent the whole population of Lehman High School. We have to make sure that our samples represent the population. Otherwise, what's the point? Okay, there's no point. You have to draw conclusions about the population. And you can only draw good conclusions if you have good data. You're going to draw bad conclusions with bad data. And I can manipulate surveys all I want. I can say I interviewed 300 people. They said that they wanted this. But those 300 people may have only just been one class. or one gender or one sex or one race. Not that that makes a difference about what type of snacks that you want in there, but it could, right? It could. Tell me what's wrong with this survey here. Suppose I ask the first 5 students to enter the class this question: how often are you tardy to class? And you answer never, rarely, occasionally, or often. What's wrong with that survey? What's wrong with the way I can?
5 people who have been in the class, so they're probably
On time every time, right? The first 5 people that come to class are going to be the same first 5 people that come to class every time. JoJo is probably the first one here every day, every time. Then followed by Claudia if she's here on campus that day. And then Draven and Ethan probably right afterwards. Christian, you're usually on time. I don't know what happened today. Unless it's usually like right before the bell, right? Okay. If this was a normal year, obviously there'd be like 30 people in here. Okay, but the first 5 people are probably the same first 5 people every single time. I did a shitty job of conducting this survey. It's not going to represent everybody, right? I could have done it. How could I have done it better? What could I have done differently besides interviewing all 30 people? Because I can still do it well and just interview 5 people. What's a better way to do it? Say it again. Do it at the end when everybody's here. How do I pick those 5 people? Only ask the people who are last? But those people could be late every time.
Ask the latest 5 people.
Okay. What else?
Ask like the first 2 people who come here.
Okay.
The second, as they come in, kind of.
Okay, so like every other person or something every like that? Person. Yeah, or every third person. That would be a really good way to do it, right? Ask 2 people in the beginning, 2 people in the middle, and then maybe 2 people at the end, right? Look right at the bell, like the first minute, ask somebody. And the second minute, ask somebody. It's 5-minute passing period. So maybe just 1 in each minute. See how that works. All right. So there are ways to make sure that your surveys are not biased. So I'm going to go over. Do you guys, first of all, do you know what bias is? Okay. Does everybody know what bias is? Do I need to explain what bias is? Because there's a lot of bias in our media and our news reporting right now. And people are just inherently biased. Okay. The last bias that we're going to talk about today, confirmation bias, which if you don't know what that is, we're gonna talk about it, and I'm gonna show you some funny clips about some confirmation bias. But we'll get back to some bias here. We got to make sure that our stuff is not biased. Tell me why this example is bad. A teacher asked the first 50 students who entered the library about their homework habits in order to estimate how long students at LHS spend on homework each night. What do you think is gonna happen? I interview the first 50 people that walk into the library. Are these people going to want to study? Do they study a lot at home or do they not study a lot at home? I could argue either way. You could say they don't study a lot at home because that's why they're there in the library in the first place, right? To get their homework done because they didn't do it the night before. Or you could say they do study a lot at home and they're just nerds that want to be in the library and study some more. I don't know. Or they're there to play Fortnite. I mean, do they do that anymore? Because I know that a lot of people just used to play video games in there. Is that still a thing? Hardly ever see anybody in the libraries now. Really? Well, you can go in. You just have to go in through the side door. Mm-hmm. The one by the office.
Yeah.
They just want you going one way.
I see like 2 kids every day on there as an aide.
Really?
Yeah.
It's so crazy because it used to be so packed all the time. Mm-hmm. So this first method of sampling badly is called a convenience sample because it was convenient for me or that teacher to just stand right in one spot and give the survey. If I just stood there at the door for interview the first 5 people that walked in, it's super convenient for me to just interview those first 5 people. That's bad. Okay. That's going to be biased totally. Now look at this chart that I put up here. If I'm the interviewer right here in the gray, and I'm literally just interviewing the people that are closest to me. Okay, there's no way to say that that's a good sample that represents everybody. Okay, that's bad. Don't do that. Okay, don't do that. The next one I like, here's an example on here, but I'm gonna give you guys another example here in a second too. But here's a touchy subject. You have this guy on CNN, he doesn't like illegal immigration. Okay, so one of the commentators says he's against illegal immigration. One of his shows is attacking a proposal to offer driver's licenses to illegal immigrants. And on his show, he tells people, go online, go to my website, vote on this survey, and I'm going to show the results. Would you be more or less likely to vote for a presidential candidate who supports giving driver's licenses to illegal aliens? What do you think people are going to say? How do you think people are going to answer that survey? Do you think they're going to agree with him or not agree with him? Depends. Exactly. They're watching him in the first place. If you didn't agree with him, would you even be watching his show? Like, I would not watch a show of somebody talking about their opinions if I did not agree with them. So, of course, I'm going to agree with that. Every single one of you has gone through a fast food drive-through or up in the store, right? At the bottom of the receipt that they give you, every fast food restaurant, doesn't matter. What's on the bottom of every receipt they give you? The what?
A survey, right?
Fill out the survey, you get a chance to win a free Doritos Locos taco, whatever, right? So, how many of you fill that stuff out? Right? You only do it for certain stores? Okay. The people that fill those surveys out are only doing so if they feel strongly about what they're filling the survey out for, right? Most of the time, you're either really, really, really happy, somebody went above and beyond, but that's not usually the case. It's usually the people that are really, really, really mad, right? They're pissed off. You forgot their Doritos Locos taco. They gave you Sprite instead of Dr. Pepper. Somebody was rude at you. Somebody spit on you. I don't know. Whatever. Okay. We've all had experiences through fast food. And some of y'all work in fast food, right? You know how this works, don't y'all? And those employees get to, where do you work, Jasmine? Taco Cabana. And what happens if you get a bad survey? What does your manager do? Nothing?
They make us take the surveys.
They make you all take them if the customer doesn't want the receipt? Yeah, we used to do that when I wasn't working in retail. Yeah. But generally, it's not up to the person giving the survey. It's not up to Taco Bell to get people to take that survey. It's up to the person. That's a voluntary response sampling. And this is bad because it only requires the people to do it. And they're only going to do it if they're incentivized to win that free Doritos Locos taco or if they feel strongly about something. They're never going to get neutral people. If I drove to the drive-thru, I got all my stuff, everything. What do they have at Taco Bell? My 7-layer burrito, y'all still have that? No, you don't have any more? Okay, whatever. If I get all my stuff, Jasmine helps me. She's nice. She's like, hey, having a great day, right? I get everything. It tastes good. It's not like great. It's not like bad. I'm not going to fill out that survey, right? It doesn't matter to me. And it's not really getting a good representation. You guys probably get those bad surveys, but your managers realize, hey, that stuff happens. And people are pissed off for other reasons besides what you guys did in the store, right? That happens. It sucks that that happens. Trust me, I was there for so long. I worked in retail for 11 years before becoming a teacher. Okay. So the voluntary response surveys are bad. And companies shouldn't be using these to fire, hire, or discipline people who work in those industries. It's just a bad thing to do in general. Okay. So why were those two types of sampling bad? Why were those bad? Well, there wasn't really a choice on there, okay? It wasn't randomized. And in order to do a good survey, you've got to randomize your survey. It's got to be random, okay? So I'm going to show you the four random ways to do surveys. If you pay attention to something, pay attention to this real quick, okay? I'm not going to explain to everything on the slide here because I'm going to show you how this works. It's pretty simple with these four different random sections. And I'm going to do four examples and see if you guys can catch on. All right. The first way to randomly do a survey or a sample is to do a simple random sample. Okay. That's where everybody has an equal chance of being selected. Let's say that everybody in this class is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. There's 10 of y'all in this class right now. All right. I know there's about 10 of you at home right now as well. I'm just because I can't see y'all, I'll just use the 10 people in this class. I'm going to assign everybody a number 1 through 10. Okay. Then I'm going to use a random number generator to select how many people I want. Let's say I want 2 people. These calculators in the back, they have random number generators. You can go onto the online. You can find random number generators. Super easy. Or I can write everybody's name down on a piece of paper and put it in a hat and draw 2 names. That's random too. As long as all the papers are the same size, same color, whatnot, right? I pick 2 numbers. And the two numbers that I get, those are the people that I survey. Key here, everybody in here had a chance of being selected, right? If I put 10 names in a hat, everybody has a chance of getting selected. That's a simple random sample, okay? That's the most basic and easy sample to do. As you can see, it's just going to be random, the people that I pick. But why would I want to do this? Let's say I'm talking about the whole school of students, 2,200. Is a simple random sample pretty easy to do at that point? If I did a simple random sample of 50 students in this school, and out of the whole school, I would have to find 50 students out of all grade levels, out of all 2,200 people. So simple random sample is not necessarily the best to do in a very large population. It's good for small ones. This is a small population, but not a very large one. So now we have some other ones that we can do. Systematic is pretty easy too. And Ethan talked about this a few minutes ago. I know, bear with me. I'm almost done here with this lesson. All right. Systematic is where we do every nth person. Okay. I still select every, I'm going to give everybody in here a number. Everybody pay attention to your number. All right. Ready? 1, 2, 3, 4. Did I hear 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and 10? All right. You all have a number? Good. I'm going to randomly, I want two surveys out of these 10. Okay, I want to select two people out of the 10. So I'm going to take, there's 10 people divided by 2, right? And I get 5, 10 divided by 2 is 5. So I'm going to pick every fifth person. But I'm going to randomly select the first person. Let's say I randomly select a number. I was going to use the calculator, but let's say I randomly select a number and the first person is 7. Okay, who's number 7? Jojo? Okay, so Jojo would be the first person, and I would pick every fifth person after that. Well, every fifth person, I have to go back to the beginning. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Now Christian would be the next person that I select. Okay, and I would, if I had a bigger population, I would do the same thing. Every fifth person after that. Okay, so I'm using it as the same interval every single time. You can see how on this example, there's number 2, and then 1, 2, 3, and then 1, 2, 3, and then 1, 2, 3, and so on. Okay. Systematic. Every nth person. Every. Two more. The next two, the last two random ones, are the ones that are often really oftentimes confused. Okay, people confuse these quite a bit. So I'm going to talk about stratified first, where I break up into groups. How could I easily break this class up into two different groups with similar traits?
2.
What? Well, 5 and 5. It doesn't necessarily have to be equal.
Gender.
It would be equal. Gender, right? Gender would be the easiest one. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 5 girls. There's 5 guys in here right now, right? I would split them up into strata. Strata have to be similar traits, so girls and guys, all right? And then I would randomly select, I'd assign everybody a number 2 again, randomly select, like say 2 from each group. So I have 2 girls and 2 guys, okay? This is a stratified sample where I break up my party into groups and I select a few from each group. And if I wanted to use the whole school, I could use the classrooms, right? The classrooms would kind of sometimes be stratified depending on like the grade level or the type of subject that they're teaching. And I could select like maybe 1 or 2 from each classroom. And that would be pretty easy for me to do. Okay, that's a stratified sample where I take a few from each group. That's why I wrote on here some from all. I take some people from all of the groups, okay? Some people from all of the groups. Last one, and we're going to take a break here. Last one is cluster. Cluster is the opposite of stratified. Instead of taking some from all of the groups, I pick whole groups all together and interview those. And those clusters have to be diverse, okay? The classrooms would definitely be diverse in this situation. All the classrooms in the school would have a pretty diverse group of students in each classroom. If I want to do a cluster sample, I assign every cluster a number. I don't no longer assign individual people numbers. Assign every cluster a number, and then I randomly select how many clusters that I want. Then I would interview everybody in that cluster. Okay. That's where I see show this phrase all from some, because I'm taking all the people from some of the groups. In this case, I took two groups. I'm going to interview all three of those people in those two groups. Okay. So we have simple random sample. Everybody has an equal chance of being selected. Systematic, every nth person, every fifth, every tenth, every second, every third. Stratified, a few from each group, and cluster, all the people from some of the groups. Okay. Help me answer these four examples with each of those four, and then we're going to take a break. All right. Guys at home, don't log off so I can give you credit for being logged in today. All right. Convenience. Joe asked about convenience sample. Convenience and voluntary response. Those are the bad ones. Okay. Convenience. It's convenient for me. Voluntary response is where you actually have to go on when you feel strongly about it. Okay. These last four examples, we're just going to review the four random ones. So tell me which one this is between. Here, I'm going to put this up. I'm going to write it up here on the top. Okay. Simple, random, sample, stratified, sample. Let me do systematic first. Systematic, sample, cluster. I'm going to do it in the order that it was. And cluster sample. All right. All first-year university students at a university are enrolled in one of 30 sections of a seminar course. To select a sample of freshmen at this university, a researcher selects four sections of the course at random from the 30 sections, and all the students in those sections are included in the sample. Out of these four, what do you think? Simple random sample, systematic, stratified, or cluster? If you guys at home are playing along, put in the chat what you think it is. Simple, systematic, stratified, or cluster. Is it a simple random sample? Is it everybody have an equal chance of being selected? Yes or no?
No.
No. Okay. Is it systematic? Is it every nth person? I don't see that every second, fifth, or whatever. Mia at home says she thinks it's a cluster sample. What do you guys think? You agree, Claudia? That is correct. It is a cluster sample. Okay. Cluster, we pick whole clusters and everybody in those clusters gets selected for the survey. Okay. Three more examples. To obtain a sample of those attending a basketball game, a researcher selects the 24th person through the door. Then every 50th person after that is also included in the sample. This should be the easiest one to identify. You agree? That is systematic. Okay, good job. That's the easiest one. Be able to see to see every nth person should be the easiest one. All right, last two. To obtain a sample of students, faculty, and staff at a university, a researcher randomly selects 50 faculty members from a list of faculty, 100 students from a list of students, and 30 staff members from a list of staff. What do you think, Christian? We just did systematic. I'm taking a few from each group. Not if I'm taking a few from each group. Stratified if I'm taking a few from each group. Okay. Everybody's broken up into similar traits. They're all either faculty members, students, or staff. Okay. Last one. Obviously, you probably know which one this is because it's the last one we haven't done, but see why it is that one. I want to take a sample of seniors at a particular high school. A researcher obtains an alphabetical list of every senior and numbers them. Then, using a random number generator, 50 students are chosen for the sample. Which one is this one? This is a simple random sample. Every senior has a chance of being selected, so I select 50 out of the total. Okay. All right. I know that was a lot. Hold on a second.